up to the two different type of transformer, right? Core type and another one is shell type. Okay. So today we will start from the ideal transformer. Okay. So I hope you know from the previous AC circuit and DC circuit that there are two cases that we will discuss every time. That one is ideal case, another one is practical case. Okay. So we will solve some numericals based on the ideal transformer and some numericals based on the practical cases. Okay. So first we have to learn what is ideal transformer. Okay. And at the end of today's class, I will show you the transformer animation, how the voltage will induce in the secondary. Okay. How you are giving the voltage in primary and you are getting one voltage in the secondary. Okay. But remember, in case of transformer, there are certain conditions that number one, the frequency here does not change during transformation. Okay. Frequency is always constant, whether it is operating in primary or secondary. Okay. Second, the flux phi, it is linked both with primary and the secondary. Fine. Number three, the power transfer is always constant. That means whatever power you are giving as input, the same amount of power you will get from the secondary side. Okay. So power will remain constant. The power transfer is always constant here. Okay. So all these cases, this case, the power is constant. This is the condition for ideal transformer. Okay. Now, what are the assumptions for ideal transformer? First, the core of the transformer is highly permeable so that it requires very small magnetomotive force to set up the flux in the core. That means this is your core. Okay. You don't need high amount of current to set that rotating, that alternating flux. Okay. A small amount of current can create this amount of flux in the core. Right. Now, second one is that its leakage flux is zero. That is, the entire flux is conformed to the core and links with both the windings. It means what? It means here, this is your primary. Okay. This is your, right? So when current flows through this type of winding, flux will be generated. Okay. Magnetic flux will be generated. And here, in case of ideal transformer, how the flux will rotate? The flux will rotate like this. Okay. Like this. Suppose if it is your primary. Okay. And in case of secondary, like this. When I show you the animation, you will clearly understand. So here, look. This flux is only created due to the current flow in the primary. This is your primary side. This is your secondary side. Okay. But in case of ideal transformer, it is taken, it is assumed that all these fluxes are linked, and whatever flux it is created in the primary, they are linked with the secondary. Okay. Like that mutual induction, one flux that is linked like this. Okay. If this is your core, okay. If, okay, don't, I am erasing this, just a minute. Okay, this is your primary coil, this is your secondary coil. Okay, so it is assumed for ideal transformer that due to the current flow in primary, whatever flux is created, all the fluxes are linked with the secondary. Okay, all those are linked with secondary, like this. Okay, all of these are linked with the secondary, but in practical case this doesn't happen. Okay, there are some fluxes that move like this. Okay, here also moves like this. Okay, they are not at all linked. So these amount of small amount of fluxes, these are called the leakage flux. Okay, now the resistance of primary and secondary winding is negligible. Here this is the primary winding, okay, that is the number of turn NP. This is secondary winding, number of turn NS. So in ideal case it is assumed that the resistance of this winding is almost zero, it is negligible. Okay, in case of NS also, but in practical case, is this really possible? No, it is not at all possible, because whatever wear or whatever carrier we choose, it has certain amount of resistance in it. Okay, so that's the difference between ideal and practical case. Right, now next one, that there are no losses due to resistance, hysteresis and eddy current. Now you tell me, is this really possible? Yes or no?
No sir,
it is not at all possible, because there, if there is certain amount of resistance, whether it is 0.5 ohm or 0.25 ohm, due to any amount of small current, there will be a loss due to heat. It will, the loss will occur because of the heat generated, right? Hysteresis, it is also there. We cannot eliminate the hysteresis loss, because all the ferromagnetic element that we are using to create, to construct the core, it has this amount of curve. Okay, maybe it is small, but it swept some amount of area, so there is small amount of hysteresis loss. We cannot neglect that. Okay, next one is the eddy current loss. Now can anyone tell me what is eddy current? Can anyone tell me what is eddy current? Okay, fine. What is eddy current? Okay, I have that there are laminas. Okay, this type of lamina, when they are added with each other, it constructs the total core. Okay, when current flows, okay, suppose this is your primary side, so some amount of winding is there, here another winding is also present. Okay, current flow in the primary, flux is created. Okay, now when this flux flows through this core, certain internal currents are created. Okay, it rotates, it flows within this core. Okay, so this current is called the eddy current. Okay, this is the internal current, it is the byproduct, you can say. Okay, so this eddy current, a very small amount of current is flowing, so this current is called the eddy current. Now this amount of, okay, just a minute, No, actually, eddy current is not that high amount of current that is that can be used as braking. Okay, but yes, it also helps to brake the train. But it is not only used for braking the train. Okay. Now, Shubham, is that clear? Okay, fine. So this is the eddy current. Now, when current flows in that core, the core has certain amount of resistance. Okay, because iron, so it has some amount of resistance. So there is some amount of loss. So that is called the eddy current loss. Okay, now these losses are totally neglected in case of ideal transformer. Last one is for in case of ideal transformer, the MMF, the magnetomotive force for secondary winding is equal to the force in the primary winding. Okay, because we have eliminated, we assumed that there is no loss. All the fluxes are linked in between the primary and secondary. Say that whatever MMF that is created in the primary, the same amount of MMF will be created in the secondary. Okay, that's why we can say that I1 N1 equals to I2 N2. Okay, now what we know that E generated in primary directly proportional to NP. Okay, that means the EMF is directly proportional to the number of turns in the primary and the secondary. Okay, EP directly proportional to NP, ES directly proportional to NS. So here I can also say that if EP directly proportional to NP, then from here I can say that VP directly proportional to NP is, can I write this, that if EP directly proportional to NP, then VP will be directly proportional to NP?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, in case of secondary also, we can say that VS is directly proportional to NS. That's why in place of N, we can write the V. That means I1 into V1 equals to I2 into V2. Or you can say that IP into VP equals to IS into VS. So that means what? What is I into V? That is nothing but the power as input given in the primary, isn't it? Voltage into current. What is the meaning of this? That is the amount of input power. So whatever input power you are giving in primary, the same amount of power you are getting from the secondary. Here you can prove that the power transfer constant in case of ideal. Okay, practical case, this never happens because there are certain amount of losses, resistance, heat loss, hysteresis loss, eddy current loss, I square R loss. So due to that loss, whatever power you are giving as input, same amount of power you don't get, because you have to exclude that amount of power, you have to subtract that losses from the input. So the rest amount of power you are getting from the output. Okay, so that is the difference. These are the differences between the ideal transformer and the practical transformer. Okay, now next one is the different kinds of transformer. Okay, distribution transformer and power transformer. So in your locality, on the pole, you have seen the transformer. Okay, one transformer is mounted. So what kind of transformer is this? What is the purpose of using that transformer, for installing that transformer in your locality? Based on their acting characteristic, based on their property, there are two types of transformer based on their usage, you can say. Okay, so that one is distribution transformer and power transformer. Okay, so what is the difference between distribution transformer and power transformer? This kind of question can be given as a short note, okay, of maximum 5 marks, not more than that. Okay, and this ideal transformer, it can be given as 3 marks or 5 marks. Okay, so you have to remember what are the differences between the ideal case and practical case. So now distribution transformer. So what are the points? Always try to remember as point wise. Okay, don't just blindly follow. Just try to remember logic wise and point wise. It will help you. Okay, so now is the a small step down transformer up to 500 kVA. Okay, their maximum rating is up to 500 kVA and they are basically step down transformer. So that means what? In your locality, that transformer serves what purpose? Suppose from the station, from the thermal power station or hydel power station, the power is coming in your area of 660 volt, maybe 660 volt. Okay, but at home, at your home, it is required of how much amount of voltage? 230 rms. okay, so you need 230 rms. So this distribution transformer steps down the voltage from 660 volt to 230 volt. That is the work of the distribution transformer. Okay, now it is used to step down the low transmission voltage to distribution voltage or distribution voltage of 11 kV to standard service voltage 440 volt. Okay, so that is the distribution transformer that you observe, you see in your locality. Okay, now these transformers are used to supply power for general purpose and minimum standard rating is 5 kVA. Okay, and they can remain energized for 24 hours a day. Now if there is some maintenance purpose, then it will be shut down. Okay, so that is the main function of the distribution transformer. Next is the power transformer. Now these transformers ratings are 500 kVA, above the 500 kVA. Okay, their rating is greater than 500 kVA. Okay, now they are used for two purposes, either stepping up or stepping down. Okay, and they are always used for high kVA ratings, high voltage ratings. Okay, and this type of power transformer, they will be operated during the load period. That means when it is the peak load. That means suppose what is load? You are using suppose the induction oven. Okay, you are using geyser, you are using air condition. So this amount of the consumption of electricity, they will define the amount of load of your home. Okay, so during the load period, the high load period, this type of power transformer can be used. Okay, now that is the difference between the distribution transformer and power transformer. Next, the transformation ratio. Okay, you already know that if E1 is the EMF generated in primary and E2 is the EMF generated in secondary, and all these values are RMS value. Okay, and what is the equation? That E1 equals to 4.44 into frequency into number of turns into phi m. That means phi equals to, because flux is also alternating in nature, phi m sine omega t. Okay, this is the maximum value of flux is here, right? Now this phi m is linked with both primary and secondary, so there will not be any change in flux. So only what will be changed? This number of turn. Okay, so that's why we can say that E1 by E2 equals to N1 by N2. Now this ratio is called the transformation ratio. Okay, this N1 by N2, it is called the transformation ratio. Now based on the transformation ratio, you can say which side, whether the transformer is acting as step up transformer or the transformer is one step down transformer. Okay, you can say that easily. Now this is okay, fine. Next, we will solve certain numericals based on the previous topic. Okay, so first it is given a 100 kVA transformer has primary secondary turns of 4000 and 1000 respectively, and induced voltage in the secondary is 1000 volt. Okay, now the primary, what is the primary voltage? You have to find out the primary and secondary full load current. Okay, the secondary current when 100 kilowatt load is present at 0.8 power factor. Okay, so first things first, you have to find out the primary voltage. So 100 kVA transformer, this is the maximum VA rating. Okay, that is the rating of the transformer. Okay, now kVA rating is 100 kVA. Okay, that is 100 kVA. N1 is 4000, N2 is 1000, and E2 value is given as 1000 volt. Okay, it is 1000 volt. Now we know that E1 by E2 equals to N1 by N2. So from here, N1, N2 is already known to you, and E2 is also known to you. So you can calculate E1 very easily. Okay, so E1 value is 4000 volt. Now what is the full load current? Okay, now here it is mistaken. Look here, and this is written as, this will be 100. Okay, this will be 100. So 100 into 10 to the power 3 divided by 4000. So that is the full load primary current. The value is 250 ampere. Okay, similarly from here, it will be not 250, it will be, I think, 25. Okay, check the calculation, because it is given 100 kVA, but here it is written 1000 kVA. So there is one mistake done here. Okay, so check that mistake and clear that. Okay, now second one is the secondary full load current, I2. So yes, based on that,
yes sir, yes, not 250, it's 25.
That will be 25, right? So similarly here, if it is 25, then this will be, I think, 100 ampere. Okay, so this will be 100 ampere. Right, so now you can get the full load primary current and full load secondary current. Clear? Now I am drawing the third question, that is question number C. Okay. Now this is your primary. Okay. And this one is your secondary. Correct. And this line decides the presence of core. Okay. And in the secondary, it is given that a load is present that consumes 100 kilowatt. Okay. A load is present that consumes 100 kilowatt and the power factor is 0.8. Now, nothing is said here whether it is 0.8 lagging or leading. So, we will consider that this 0.8 power factor is lagging. Okay. It is lagging. Now, why we are considering lagging? Because look, what is the element? This coil. They are nothing but inductors. Okay. And if inductors are present in the system will be obviously lagging in nature. Okay. So by default, if nothing is said, we will consider that the system is lagging in nature. Okay. Clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So the secondary current 100 kilowatt and it is given as 0.8 power factor. So 100 kilowatt means what? Which kind of power is this? Active power or reactive power? What kind of power is this? Active power or reactive power? Or apparent power?
Active power.
Right.
Active power.
Active power. Because its unit is watt. Okay. If always remember, if your unit is watt, then it is your active power. Okay. Active power. And it must be denoted by the word P, capital P. If it is given as var. Okay, it may be K bar, it may be M bar, okay, then it is your reactive power, okay, and it is denoted by the letter capital Q, okay, and if VA is present, then that decides your apparent power, okay, it decides the apparent power. It is the VA rating of the instrument. Okay. It is decided by the letter capital S. Okay. So based on the unit, observing the unit, we can say what amount of, what is the power nature, whether it is active, reactive or apparent power. Correct. Now, so it is your active power. And what is the equation that we know that active power equals to V I cos theta, isn't it? Do you remember this? Okay. So P equals to V I cos theta. Now, which amount, which values are known to you? P value is known to you, correct? And cos theta value is also known to you. Voltage value is known to you. So you can easily find out the amount of current. Okay. Because P value is 100 kilowatt. That's why 100 into 10 to the power 3. Next. This is your cos theta. 0.8. Okay. And if and the voltage value is 1000. Why? Because this is connected in the secondary. So that's why secondary voltage will be present. Is that clear? Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, I2 value is 125 ampere. Okay, now if it is said that instead of 100 kilowatt, it is written as 100 kthor, then what will you do? 100 kVAR, then what will you do? Tell me, this one is...
Sir, then VI sine phi.
Okay, just a minute. Then it will be U. I will write U equals to VI sine phi or theta. Okay, you are taking this one phi. Fine, next. Next, what should I do?
So then you will convert the power factor in sine theta.
Exactly. So what is the value? 0.6. Okay. If cos theta is 0.8, then sine theta or sine phi, it will be 0.6. Then Q value is also known to you. V value is also known to you. So you can definitely find out the I value. Okay. Clear?
Yes.
Now, okay. Now, next numerical. A 200 by 400 volt 50 hertz transformer has a peak flux density of 1.1 Weber per meter square. So, what is the transformer nature? Whether it is step up or step down?
So, step up.
Exactly. Because your primary is 200 and secondary is 400. So, you are getting the higher amount of transformed voltage. So that's why it is one step up transformer. Okay, so next, what is given? The net area of cross section of the core is 0.02 square meter, that means meter square. If the current density in the conductor is 3 ampere per millimeter square, and the conductor diameter of primary coil is 3 millimeter, then determine the KVA rating of the transformer and number of primary and secondary turns. So what you have to find out? The KVA rating. That means you have to first find out the voltage amount. Okay, voltage amount, is it known to you? Yes, that is known to us, because voltage amount is already given. Okay, 200 by 400. Next, is the current value known to us? No. So we have to find out the current amount. Okay. Now, next, the number of primary and secondary terms. That means NP you have to find out and NS you have to find out also. Okay. Now, what values are given? The peak flux density, that means your phi m value is given as 1.1 Weber per meter square, or you can write it 1.1 Tesla, capital T. Okay, 1.1 capital T. The net area of cross section is given, A value. Okay, so that these values are written here. Look, the diameter of the primary coil of the conductor is 3 millimeter. Okay, that is your D. The cross section you can find out very easily, 7.068 square millimeter. Okay, this is your primary coil. Okay, so the primary coil, that means you can say this is the D primary, this is your A in primary. Now, what is the current density? It is given as 3 ampere per millimeter square. Okay, so if you multiply 3 ampere per millimeter square, then if you multiply with this current density with area, then you can find out the total amount of current in the primary coil. Okay, because look at the unit, ampere per millimeter square, it is known to us. Okay, next, the area is also known to us. So if we multiply, then the total amount of current we can calculate. So this value is 21.2 4 ampere. So now the current is known to you. Okay, so voltage is known, current is known. So you can calculate the KVA amount. Okay, next, the KVA amount is known to you. So you can calculate this one very easily, right? Next, what we have to find out? The number of turns in primary and secondary. So how can we find out? Use this equation, EMF equation, that E1 or EP equals to 4.44 into F into phi M into NP. So phi M is known to you. Frequency is also given, that is 50 hertz, and 4.44 multiplied. So from here you can find out the N1 value. And remember, if it is fraction, then we have to do the full amount of full number, one integer. If this value is suppose 40.83, so you have to consider that N1 value is your 41, not 40. Okay, so from here you can calculate the N2 value also. Okay, so is there any confusion till now?
No, sir.
Okay, so this one is the numerical for your assignment. Okay, if you can solve it, take a snapshot. If you can solve it, post that in WhatsApp. Okay, or you can send me if you solve this one. Have you taken the snapshot?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So with this, I am concluding today's class. All of you give your attendance in the chat box. Okay, and one more thing, your syllabus for the first class test is the first module only. Okay,
okay,
so
sir.
Prepare the first module. And one more thing, that I don't know when your exam will occur. It may be suppose the end of March or first of April. So don't you think that we have to prepare only the first module? Prepare first, second, both modules. Okay, because first module is already discussed and all of you already prepared that. Okay, so prepare both the modules. Okay, give importance with both the modules, but first module will be in your syllabus for the first class test. Okay, so regarding the first